I have to give you a little warning. This is not the theory. I mean, I don't think that does exist a theory about data reduction. I show just you the main steps, as I told, the main steps of the reduction, and I give you my recipe for cooking, I mean, extracting spectra. So let me change the title of the talk in not a shell spectra reduction, but the art of cooking spectra with IRAF. Oh, this is my art of cooking spectra. In some cases, there are the steps are always the same for all of us. In some part of the reduction, each users, each astronomers can give his artistic view. Okay, this is a typical shell spectra that we acquired at the telescope, and we want to pass from this image to a normalized spectra like this one. So reduction is all the with reduction we can mean all the operation that let us to go from these images to this kind of images to the normalized spectrum. During the night in a telescope when we are observing, usually we take different kind of images from bias, flat field lamp, calibration lamp, and the objects. Oh. That's okay. Okay, I think it's fine. I cannot see here in my... No. Okay, I'll try. Okay, these are the list of the floods of the images acquired with the Hermes telescope. Maybe it's not so visible from behind, but we have a series of objects. The files. Did you have the IRAF installed on your laptop? I guess so. Yes. You have an XG term open with IRAF launched, because if you don't have an XG term, it's you can have some problem in some IRAF packages. So the first, if you don't have, you have to install it. It's very simple, because you have to just download it from the IRAF site and launch into in your laptop. There is nothing to install, just retrieve the new window, the XG term terminal. After you have an XG term, you can launch a CL, the CL command of IRAF in it. Oh, anyway. These are the objects. We have a series of bias, a series of flat field, the image called FF, and a series of calibration lamp, Torio argon. What is the reduction process? So, consists of a series of operations aimed at removing or taking into account the defects of the CCD or some problems of the CCD that could affect the final spectrum. And these are kind of operations that we can perform before the extraction of the shell order or the cell spectrum. These are typical images. We can blow up some square. These are the orders, the shell orders, in which are the spectrum are we have to extract. These are the continuum. These are the absorption lines. This group is formed at telluric, and this is scattered light. Let's see the light in this area. The light in the background of this area is more or less scattered light that we have to remove before extract the aperture. Basic steps. Basic steps are overscan subtraction and image trimming. Trimming because we can remove from scratch all the parts of the image that are not spectrum or there are too much noise. So we can trim before. Bias subtraction. Remove all the bias of the zero level from the image, from any image. Subtraction of the scattered light. Then the spectral reduction. So these operations are operation of some kind of cosmetics to the images before do the real extraction. The spectral extraction, the division by flat field spectrum, the wavelength calibration, and then normalization to the continuum. Then we can do other operation as, I don't know, for example, put the spectrum to the rest of frame to correct for the radial velocity of the our planet around the sun, just to make an example. What is the bias? The bias is an exposures with the exposure time zero taken at the telescope with the shutter closed, so we no light in this way. We don't have light about from the stars on the detector, and all the signal that we have is just the noise or the background level produced by the detector. To combine in IF, to combine the biases, we can use the task zero combine. And do you have just to know? Sorry, guys. Do you have an idea about IRF? Did you have used IRF in the past? So you know what the task EPAR do. So with the EPAR zero combine, for example, we can edit all the parameters of a task and change it according to our needs. For example, with zero combine let us to combine all the biases, but we have to specify some parameters. For example, readout noise is a gain of our CCD, of the detector. Gain is the convection factor between a DU and electrons. The readout noise is the noises the due to the reading of the CCDs. These parameters depend on the instruments, on the detector. So for any detector that you are using, we have different parameters. Gain, readout noise, and you can find it on the paper that describing the instruments. For example, for Hermes, there is a paper in the... I don't remember the author, sorry, I have it here. I mean, there are papers with describing the instruments, all these parameters are inside this paper. These are typical bias. If we extract a line of the CCD in the middle, what we have is an image like this one. This oscillating is, of course, the noise. The white are one typical bias lump. The red ones is the combination between all the bias that we take in during the night. We can view here. Oh, I created some files, bias.lst, flat.list, star.list, and toriargon.tar.list, in which these are lists of the of our images. For example, we can use the size bigger. I'll try. For example, more bias. Okay, it's just a list of all the bias that I wanna combine. So if I use the task zero combine, These are the tasks zero combine, in which I, with this symbol, we just saying to RF that the name is a list of files, is not just one image. If we don't, the at symbol. So we have the list of files that wanna average, the output name of the file, zero in this case, the type of combination that wanna do average in this case, and the rejection algorithm for the some cosmic ray or some spike. These are important parameters, the L sigma and H sigma is the lower sigma and the upper sigma clipping factor. And also we have the red noise, redout noise in electrons and the gain in ADU over electron. Now these are averaging all the bias. Let's see one, for example. This line, for example, like this one, I'm just a start. Okay. I'm just extracting one line of the image of the average, of the one single image in this way. This from 0 to 4,000 pixels. So no, it's in this way, but I mean it's the same. So I can put over there. I can overimpose the average. This is the average that we created now. So if you, the noise is always reduced. So the overscan is if you look at these images here, now it's maybe for the color is not visible, but in the edge of the CCDs there is a little strip that is the overscan strip. This is not a physical the CCDs, but it's just just the electronic noise of the instrument or the detector. We can take into account also this electronic noise in the overscan and fit it when we try to remove the bias to the images. We have to tell IRF where the strip is, and these are the coordinates, the overscan strip image section. These are the coordinates of the two corner, left and bottom left and upper right, the coordinates in pixels of the corner in which the overscan strip image is. And we can say it's also to IRF where is the section that we can that we want to eliminate from the images. All these operations are doing with the CCD proc task. CCD proc is processing all the CCD images that we have. Flat, stars, and Toro argon calibration lamp. The parameters are simple. We can say to IRF that we want to apply the overscan correction, put yes here. We want to trim the image, so put yes. And we want the zero level correction. Specify the coordinates of the overscan of the trim data section and which is the name of the images, the zero image, and then also we can give the parameters about the overscan, the fit of the overscan, The first time we can do the scanning, the fit of the scanning iteratively, but once we have established we are the fitting function, for example, here a Legendre function, the number of polynomial terms that one use, we can do this operation in non-interactive way, just to save time. For example, here I want to process all the flat images. In this way, I mean, apply the overscan strip, trim the images, apply the zero level correction, and the CCD proc is the routine, is the packages over there for the do all these operation. We have to prepare a master flat for the same, in the same way. I mean, we can average all the flats that we taken during the night and prepare just one master flat. To do this, we can use Orin combine or flat combine task. Flat combine is written specifically for flat. Can process all the flats before and then average it.
I'm sorry, just what was I was battling with the zero combine. What was the last step you were doing? Something before
five. Overscan.
Overscan.
Overscan. Yeah, just take into account the overscan region and correct for the overscan all the images. I started with the flat image with the flat images, and then I'm averaging the flat.
But, so you use CCD pros? Yeah, because, sorry, we were struggling with zero combine because there were some problems with headers and so on. And so overscan was made on which images? I mean, on which bits?
Overscan is not a physical images. It's just a lecture of the CCDs. It's a kind of, when you read the CCDs, you don't stop at the physical ending of the CCDs, but you go over, and the over signal is not physical signal, it's just the electronic noise of all the electronic noise of the instrument. So taking into account of the overscan, you take into account only the noise, or electronic noise, thermal noise, that are coming from the instrument. It's not physical images. So it's a kind of bias. It's a kind of zero level that have in account only the electronic sources of noises. Okay, this is for flat combining. The flat list, the name of the new image. As we did for zero combine, the average, basically as the algorithm for rejection, and the parameters for the median, for the average. The size of the image is this one. The corner of the first CCD on the left. And these are the size of the image that you want to keep. So the CCD is greater than this one. This is the images that you want to keep. So just removing some images on the boundaries.
Because we cannot see the number.
Oh, sorry. It's one This is the syntax. It's 1:148, comma, 50:4600. But keep in mind that this is my choice. So this is my, this is my artistic impression about this Hermes data. Maybe for you, the data that you want to keep are less or greater than the size of the images. It's a square parenthesis, 1:2148, comma, 50:4600, square parenthesis closed.
If you don't specify
the
object file,
which file? If you don't specify any output file, you don't have any output file at the end. So the system crashes. Say you give me an output file, please. No, okay. If you have a list. You keep the same name, you create a new file with the same name. So you overwrite your previous file. And I suggest you don't do this because it's useful to keep all the passages. So I have this problem. If you don't specify a new file, new name, he save the new file overwriting the previous one. You're right, it's not crash, but... So, so now we have to remove the scattered light from the CCDs, from the images. Scattered light is a clear scene between the spectral orders when the star signal is higher and the orders are closer. It can be due to several causes, maybe some defects in the optics or some dust grains in the during the light path. It can be removed, and to do this, I'll just show you the example. The white orders are the images before the scattered light subtracted. The red one is after this operation. So you see there are more scattered light here when the flux is higher. So we have to, in this case, of course, the scattered light at the maximum is some 10 ADU. So it's not so much, but in any case, it's better to remove it because a priori we don't know how much is the scattered light. So it's better to proceed with this remove. This is the background of the subtraction. How we can remove the scattered light? We can use the task AP scatter. This is a part of the shell package of IRAF. AP scatter is allow the user to remove the scattered light and also to trace and to define where the orders are. We can choose usually. I choose a reference star. I mean, because the spectrograph is fiber linked to the telescope. Usually, I choose a star that have a lot of signal. In this way, it's easier to track to choose the position of the orders, and then to use these stars as reference for the others in the in our sample in the other images taken during the night. So choosing the one of these. Let's say run task interactive, yes, because it's the first time. Find aperture, yes. Recenter, yes. Resize, yes. We want to edit, trace, and fit the trace point interactively because it's the first time. Subtract, scatter the light, smooth, scatter the light. Fit, scatter the light interactive, yes, for the first time, and smooth, yes, for the first time. What we obtain now doing with this operation is a trace, a cut of the CCDs, of the major CCDs in the middle, with the order in this way. And we had to say to IRAF where the orders are, which this is a typical, this is a blow up of an order, with 18 order. We had to say where the order is, where approximately the how much the order is wide. And give us also some feet about the background, with the scatter of the light in the background. At the beginning, I'll ask you the number of aperture to be found automatically. If we don't know, let's put one. Resize, aperture, edit, yes. It's a problem. No. There was a problem. For each order, IRAF is calculating the center of the aperture. Each of these points here, corresponding with one pixel, is the center in a pixel of the aperture. So it's taking the first aperture, for example, this one, is taking the first aperture, calculating the center of the aperture, and plotting in this. And plotting here how the aperture are distributed along the shell order. So we have to fit this aperture, of course, with a function Legendre with order 2 is not enough. With this kind of order, we choose an order greater than 2. Sorry. Okay, when I want to show you all the operation. So after do this this fit of the first aperture, we start with all the aperture. What we get at the end, if a new image, a temporary image that you cannot see, it's a temporary image with all this aperture along the dispersion fitted. And a new image with the fits in each line is temporarily created. And after this, this new image is fitted in the other direction. So at the end, we have a surface of scattered light created in a in a temporary image that it removed between it will be removed in all the spectra, in all the images. We have advantage with the Fieber Eschel spectrograph because all the objects have the same will have the same position on the detector. So once we have found this parameter for the first star, all these parameters could be useful to extract the aperture, to extract the orders in the other images. If we don't have an Eschel a spectrograph linked with a telescope via Fieber, but directly attached to the telescope, this kind of operation it could not be performed. So in this case, we have to search for parameters, I mean for the position of the order, for the position of the aperture, star by star. So in this case, it's very simple. Just do it for the first one and apply the same parameters for all the other stars and flat taken during the night. In fact, in the second part of the aperture extraction, we put the name of the reference stars here in the list of aperture reference images, and we said no to all the question, run the task interactive no, find aperture no because we did, recenter aperture no, and so, just yes, reply yes, just in subtract scattered light, a smooth scattered light along the dispersion. This created the images of scattered light for each spectra subtracted automatically. Okay. Spectra extraction. So spectra extraction is the next step. Till now we did to IRF where the aperture are, where the shell order are. We removed the scattered light, but we don't yet extract the orders. So this is the next operation. For this operation, we have to use. We can use the APSAM. We can use APSAM. Is another task of the Eschel package. APSAM allow us to extract the information on the orders, I mean sum all the pixels in the same order, just to obtain the spectrum. We can use this, we can put yes in these clean parameters. This is useful to replace bad pixel. So I mean it's useful to delete cosmic rays, but with a warning. He did a kind of average. I mean, if he found a cosmic ray, he did an average between the pixels on the left and the pixels on the right of the bad one, and substituting the bad one with an average of the pixel behind and above. So it could be useful for a kind of cosmetic, but we lost, of course, the information on that pixel, on the pixel that we are removing. Okay. This is the one of order extracted. This is the order of the H alpha, the 16th order of our Hermes spectra. This shape is the blazing function. I mean, it's how the spectrograph, it's how the detector, the CCD is illuminated from the spectrograph. The blazing function could be a problem. I mean, it could be a problem remove it because of its shape. It's a Legendre function of high order. But if we take in account the flat field has two reasons to be used. Once it removes all the defects of the CCDs, pixel by pixel division, you can remove some defects. But also, it is useful for removing the shape of the blaze function on the spectral order. So this is another point in which the artistic impression could be important, because you have to look our flat. You have to look your flat. If the flat is good, there is no defect on it. Okay, you can use it to recover the pixel by pixel function and use it on the on your stars. But sometimes in the flood there are some pixel hot, for example, with some bad spike in it. So in that case, don't use the flood just without having a look, because you will introduce some noise on the spectrum. So the main purpose of the flood is help us to recover the fun, to recover the stars as better as possible. If there is some problem in the flood and this operation is not be performed, don't do it. So it's not necessary to divide it by flood if the flood is not so good. For example, so if you take a flood during the night with not too much exposure time, okay? If you look at it, the oscillation around the medium, around the Bredt function is very high. If you divide it for this flood, you introduce noise on your spectrum. So in that case, it's better do not use any flood. Okay, just a warning. Use the flood, use the division by flood after having a look at the flood itself. So in this case, okay, this case is a good flood. We can use it. Okay, remember, this is the images of the order, the shell order number 16. This is the flood of the same order. This is the division between the star spectra, the stellar spectrum, and the flood. As you see here, the most part of the Bredt function has been removed. This is useful because above in these cases of broad wings, in lines at the H alpha lines with broad wings, now it's easier to try to normalize the spectrum, I mean to find a continuum in the spectrum. It was very complicated to try to search a continuum here, because here we don't know if this part of the spectrum is the line, is the continuum, or is the wing of the line. In this way, it's easier to do this. We have continuum here. Let's start with the line. Of course, in the shape spectrum, like MS1, the Balmer lines are on the, as in this case, are on the edge of the order. So it's very complicated to normalize and use these lines to recover stellar parameter, or for example, the gravity, because fitting this line, the wing of this line is not so easy, because we are not sure about the normalization. Okay. The most absolutely, my opinion, annoying part of the spectral reduction is the calibration. So till now we have a spectrum not calibrated in lambda, in wavelength. We have a spectrum in pixel. But if you want to get some information in this spectrum, you have to calibrate it in lambda. So you need a function that help you to help to convert a pixel in wavelength. We can do this just using the HEidentify task. But we need an atlas of the Torrio Argon lab. We need an atlas to identify our lines. So I show you how a lamp is. Okay, this is our Torrio Argon lamp. It's easier here because it's almost calibrated. But let's imagine to see these lines, these emission lines, with no wavelength, there's no wavelength scale here, but just pixel. We have to compare these images with the images of our catalog. A catalog is looks like this one. The images of the lamp with the single lines identified and with the wavelength written on the top. It's not easy for the, when at the beginning, to recognize this configuration and this one. So it's easy here because I know that in the 16 order there is the H alpha, so I know which is the which is the Weber and the H alpha. So I know in which region we are, I am, and then it's easy to recognize in this way, the, for example, these four lines here. But for example, let's do a, let's zoom here. Let's zoom here. Let's say this line, these four lines, 1, 2, 3, and 4, are these 1, 2, 3, and 4. And this line that is the biggest in the in this frame is this one that is not biggest in the atlas. So let's see the difference. We have two big lines, one small and another big one. We have a scale of line in decreasing. So the which is the problem? The problem is that you have to take in account the distance between lines and not the relative intensity, because the relative intensity of each emission lines depends on the moment in which they did the calibration, in which they take the lamp at the telescope. Depends on the composition of the lamp. See, okay, of course, all the lamps are thorium-argon, for example, but if you are more thorium or more argon, the image could be different. So don't look at the strength of the lines, of the intensity of the lines, of the emission lines in the calibration spectra, but look only at the distance between lines. The distance between lines is important to define, to recognize the image and the calibrate it. When once you have recognized each line, you have just, for example, here. Click on the line with M. He asks, of course, for the this is the pixel of the line, the central pixel of the line, 2507. This is the wavelength of the line in the feet that there are in the feet that the IRF is doing, and these are the previous. Not the previous. So these are the line in the IRF database databases that is close to this pixel. That is close to the fit. If it's correct, you have just to put return. If it's not correct, and in the most cases is not at the beginning is not, you have to write manually the right wavelength that you read here in the that you will read here in the atlas. So let's think that we have, in the case of Hermes, 54, 55 orders. Each orders contain, I don't know, 100, maybe not 100, but 50 lines to be identified. So it's a very hard task and annoying task. But IRF could help us in this way. I mean, we can, IRF has a database with all the lines of the thorium-argon lamp. So we can just identify two or three lines for each order, try to get a first function, a first solution of the calibration function, maybe not more accurate, but anyway, as a first approximation is good, and then use the automatic identification task of IRF that help us to take the best solution and to do a fit like this one. So what we have here, okay, is a order by order. We have 54 order in this Hermes spectra. Order by order, we have a fit of the with the Chebyshev function, but we can use also a legend function. In this case of order 5 in the x y direction. And we have order by order all the lines identified and the residual of the fit. So when this residual is a good number, and this is another point about the artistic view of the IRF reduction, how is the good number? I mean, usually with when your root mean square is about to 0.001, 0.002 is a good fit. And it's a good fit. And then order by order, you can see how the how your fit is good or not. You can eliminate it, you can remove some lines. If, for example, this line of is, for example, the line here, the lines here, have I know a residual too wide for us, we can remove it with the, just for example, and fit again with F, fit again the function. So this iteration could be performed all the times that we want, just until we get a good root mean square as solution. So and then we can see all the fit of all the lines. With K and J, I switch between orders, and we can, switching between orders, select some lines. Of course, more lines we choose, more accurate is the solution that, that we get about the wavelength calibration. And then depends on what is the, your scientific aims with the spectra. If we are aimed in measuring radial velocity, for example, for searching or binary companion, or searching planets, whatever you want, of course the calibration in lambda should be more accurate. 0.002 root mean square could be a good number. If we are just interested in calculating atmospheric parameters, I mean fitting Balmer lines for temperature or fitting metal lines for chemical composition without take too much to the radial velocity, so you can also use a wavelength calibration with the more with less root mean square with the less less accurate. I'll just show you how a file, a calibration file, is in IRF. We have the number. This is one of the first iteration. In this iteration, I found 49 lines. These are the orders, so two lines in the seven order. In the this is the wavelength. Sorry, this is the pixel position. This is the wavelength of the fit. This is the wavelength that I put manually. These are all the orders. So I try. I find the first solution. Then I did other iterations to improve the solution to put more lines till the final iteration with. Anyway, okay, I show you here. The, okay, at this point we don't have yet the spectra calibrated in lambda. We have just to say to IRF which is the lamp, and using the task ref spectra, reference spectra, assign this lamp, assign this reference spectra to the image that you want to calibrate. Then with the DISP core task, is the dispersion correction, is IRF apply this solution to the stellar images. So after the DISP core, we actually have the spectra calibrated, wavelength calibrated. Like this one. So let's see, for example, this this part of the spectrum. This one of the star. Okay, if we see at the, this part of the continuum, we can measure, for example, the signal to noise. Using the key M and M. Let's suppose, okay. So this aspect, the spectrum in this part of the continuum, the signal to noise is 70. It's in the first part, when we choose the wide of the aperture, here, for example, it's just warm. Okay, for example here. in order to choose this aperture, I make a choice. The choice was to say to IRF that the aperture is wide till 1/10 to the maximum height of the aperture. This was my choice, for example. This choice that I did here affect the signal to noise in the continuum. I want to say, if I choose a narrow aperture, maybe the signal to noise here could be better. If I choose a wider aperture, it's true that I put more tertiary signal in the aperture, but also I put here more noise, because in this part of the aperture there are more noise than signal. So the choice of the it's another artistic view. The choice of the aperture, that is the choice of the user. It's not a choice of the spectrograph or a choice of the whatever. It's a choice of you that reduce your data. If you choose an aperture wider or narrow, or narrower, the continuum is affected in the noise. So you have to know your data. You have to know the condition of the in which your data has been observed. If you have to know if you can open or close the aperture there to obtain a more signal to noise. I want to say, if you have a very bright star, okay, and you are interested in a very high signal to noise spectrum, okay, in this case you can choose to choose a very narrow aperture, choose the first pixels around the maximum. In such a way you avoid to put inside the aperture the noisy part of the aperture. But if you don't have a very bright star, if you don't are interested in high signal to noise spectrum, for example you want to just compute the radial velocity of a binary using big features as some metal lines. So in this case you can open the aperture as you want, put all the aperture inside the trace. Okay, you will get a noisy spectrum, but if the star is not bright, it could be a good opportunity, a good chance to succeed in your purpose. So that's why, I mean, when I said at the beginning, this is my recipe is of the spectral reduction. I think that each of us could have his recipes and make the reduction, spectral reduction, good for scientifically good for the purpose of each of us. So that's all. I don't want to pass a wrong message about the artistic impression or the artistic view or the data reduction. I mean, data reduction is some of a rigorous and scientific way to work with images to get the final spectrum. The artistic view, I want to say, try to think at your data, try to work on your data, considering your purpose. If your for example, don't lost so much time in wavelength calibration. If you don't need a very accurate weather calibration. If you want to just have the Balmer lines for temperature purpose, don't lost 1 or 2 days in weather calibration. It's useful, it's not useful. On the contrary, if you want to find new planets around some stars using spectra, so this is the case in in spending a lot of time in wavelength calibration, because the results, of course, about the velocity is very important. So also the case of the aperture. If you don't need a very high signal to noise ratio, don't lose time in choose the right aperture. Usually 1/10 to the maximum is a good compromise. So also for the flat field. Flat field is one of the most annoying thing, because you have to calibrate, you have to divide the image, the star image, the stellar image for the flat. Just for example, if you wanna okay, let's see here. Okay, let's see this part of the spectrum. We are in the red, not so far from the visible, but we are in the red. This is the images of the star Kik 0766 and so. Let's see this image before the flat correction. Let's see, this is the same star extracted, but not calibrated, of course, and not divided by the flat. It's very hard here to see some features, stellar features. But when we divided this star for the corresponding flat, we get this. No, sorry. Okay, we get this. So in this case, for example, if we are for some scientific reason interested in studying these lines, I don't know which lines is or the other one. So in this case, it's very important a good division by the flat. If we are interested in some blue region, just for example here, number 22. Okay. This is the images without. Okay, don't look at the continuum calibration, it's very rough. But in any case, it's not calibrated. May I have a monitor, a big monitor? So let's see. The spectra is almost identical. So we can recognize these are the sodium lines. We see all the features here and here. So that means that for in this order, the division by the flat is important, but not so important as in the red part. Because in the red part, maybe there are some fringe of the CCDs, there are some problems with the CCDs that could be removed by the division of the flat. So these are all the things that I need. That I mean when I say artistic view, artistic cooking of the spectral reduction.
Giovanni, would you consider, apart from flat field, would you consider like a bright star or standard star for your place correction?
Yes, sometimes it's useful. I consider to take a spectrum of a hot star, for example, when we want to take into account the telluric lines, or we want to take into account the interstellar lines. because in this case, with an hot stars with a high rotational velocity, all the very high rotational velocity, all the stellar features are so shallow, they are confusing in the continuum. So all the lines that we see are or telluric, atmospheric telluric lines or interstellar lines. So in that case, I use the spectrum of, as a flat field, a spectrum of a hot star, just to remove these kind of features. Yeah.
Sometimes you might be interested in long spectrum, so you need to merge the orders one by one. Can you comment a bit about it? Because I think
yeah. Okay. In that case, when it's important the calibration, because we have to be sure that at the beginning, at the in the edge of the each order, the calibration is good, because we want to overimposing. For example, here, 22. Let's see, the red one is the white one is the end of the order 23. The red one is the beginning of the order 22. So the first thing that we have to do is be sure that the calibration is good if you want to sum these two parts of the spectrum. In this case, it is. It means that the wavelength calibration is it was very, very good, and we can sum and average these two spectrum. Just doing a sum between the white one, the red one, and then divided by two. This is the normal operation that usually I do when we want to merge the several orders. Sometimes, but I can do this because in these two cases the singular to not two orders are similar. When we have the case in which we have an order with a very good, a good signal to noise at the end, and the other order have a bad signal to noise at the beginning, it's not useful to do the sum, because you not improved but put some noises on the good spectrum. So in that case, I prefer to cut just for example. Yes, this is the part with a good signal to noise, and the red one is in the part with a bad signal to noise. I just prefer to cut here and load some information in this region. I suppose that it's not some important, and considering the other part of the spectrum. So also in this case is an artistic view. So it depends on the spectrum, it depends on my purposes. There are another question there?
Do you have any specific atlas for thorium argon lamp that is used for?
Oh no, not specific. I mean, I find
the
one.
Can you use the default one?
Sorry.
Can you use the default line list that is in IRAF?
No, there is a default file in the IRAF distribution.
It's
useful. Yeah, it's useful for the most part of the purposes. Sometimes you have not thorium argon lines, but the thorium argon neon or thorium argon helium lines. So in that case, you have to choose the other file. There are several files in the other direct distribution. Or in any case, you can create your own. I mean, if you have a lamp with some different chemical elements, you can create, edit that file, and add your lines. But usually, in general, for me, for my experience, all the files that are in the IRF distribution, it will be enough for my thorium argon. This one, the other.
The other was about normalization, because what I think is that it is really important to have a good normalization if you want to do like some spectral analysis, like chemical abundances or something like this. Because if you do it wrong,
it is because if you have a wrong estimation of the continuum, for example, if you measure equivalent width, okay, if you want to recover abundance with equivalent width. Equivalent width means that you have to measure, for example, in this case, we have to measure the area between this point, just for example, this point and this point, okay? If we, this means that this is the continuum. If the continuum is wrong, I mean, if I put the continuum down this level or up this level, the equivalent width that they measure is wrong. Just an example. This is not normalized. Let's suppose it's a good normalization. We want to measure the equivalent width from here to here. Okay, we get an equivalent width of almost 1.1. Okay, there are pixels, it's not calibrated. 1.12 pixel. That's okay. Come back, it's 3005. Come back to the previous and normalize it again in another way. This is too much wrong, just to show you the difference. No, sorry. Again. Before. No more? Oh yes, again, okay. This is the same line as before, but normalize it in different way with a different function. So if I get the equivalent width now, is 1.160 pixel. So the number is different. That's why this is the problem. If you want to measure an equivalent width, or for example, if you're measuring Balmer lines for temperature purposes, effective temperature purposes, if you are as you are interested in the line profile or in the equivalent width, the wrong choice of the continuum alter this profile, the profile of the line. So alter your equivalent width or alter your wings profile. In both cases, the equivalent width is different, is wrong. So the abundance that you get is wrong. Or in the case of the line profile of the Balmer lines, if the wing are the wings are not divided by the right fit, they could be put up or put down. So the gravity that you can get is completely different from the
true value. So it's extremely, if you are interested in chemical analysis, in effective temperature, in gravity determination, the right choice of the continuum is important. If you are interested in radial velocity, for example, okay, it's not so important, okay?
But you can do it well with IRAP tools. I mean, the continuum.
Yes, but when you have the Blaze function, mm-hmm. it's difficult to choose the continuum. This is a good case because this has not started and we have a good continuum. But let's imagine a spectra of a cool star with a lot of molecular bands in the blue region, for example. So in that case, it's very difficult to choose the continuum. You have a good tools in IRF, but you don't know where the continuum is. You have difficult to choose the continuum. Okay, the problem is not the tools that you are using, it's the way that you use to choose the continuum. Here, it's very easy. In this case, it's very easy. But let's imagine a broad feature as molecular bands or something like that. In that case, it's very difficult to choose the continuum. Yeah.